So today's topic is soil, and now we are going to study what is soil. Soil is a loose mixture of water, organic matter, and small rock particles that covers much of the land.
So our next topic is factors affecting the soil. So what are they? The first one is changing temperature, second running water, third wind, and fourth some chemical and organic changes. Our next topic is soil classification. On basis of location, soil can be classified as two types: in situ, residual or sedimentary soil, and ex situ or transported soil. So, how are in situ soil formed? They are formed in the original position by the breaking of parent rocks. Example: black, red, and laterite soil. An example of an in situ soil is shown in the picture. Now we move on to the ex situ soil. They are transported by various agents of erosion and consist of sediments carried and deposited by rivers and winds. Example: alluvial soil. In this picture, it is an example of ex situ soil, which is an alluvial soil. And classified on the basis of the origin and formation also, which are as follows: alluvial soil, red soil, black soil, and laterite soil. So first we'll go through the alluvial soil. It is formed by the sediments brought down by the rivers. It is also called riverine soil because it is mainly found in the river basins. It is of two types: bhangar. It is older alluvium composed of lime nodules or kankar, which is a clay composition. Khadar, it is light in color and is composed of new deposits. Now, through some characteristics of alluvial soil. In Upper Ganga Valley, soil is dry, porous, sandy, faint yellow, and consists of clay and organic matter. In Lower Ganga Valley, soil is more compact, less coarse and more moist. It is light and porous and easily tillable, and it is rich in potash and lime and deficient in nitrogen and humus. These two are the chemical properties of alluvial soil. Next comes the crops which grow well in this soil. Those are wheat, rice, sugarcane, cotton, tobacco, gram and oil seeds. So now we are going to study about black soil. It is also called reduced soil. That is because it has been derived from the word raguda, a Telugu word which means lava, and it is called black cotton soil because it is black in color and it is suitable for cotton cultivation. It is formed at the place of its origin over the underlying rocks. It is formed by the denudation of volcanic rocks. Thus it is also called lava soil. So now, next comes characteristics of black soil. It is fine textured and clay in nature. Some chemical properties are: it is rich in lime, iron and magnesium, and is poor in phosphorus, nitrogen and organic matter. It is very clay and thus highly water retentive. Expand where it is wet, so it is difficult to plow. In dry season, black soil shrinks and develops big cracks which help in air circulation. Moisture retentiveness makes it suitable for dry farming. Crops are cotton, jowar, wheat, sugarcane, linseed and gram. So now, red soil. It is formed by prolonged weathering of ancient crystalline and metamorphic rocks by rainfall. Formation also depends on parent rock material and climatic conditions. It is red in color due to the presence of iron oxide, and it is yellow when it is hydrated. Some crops are vegetables, rice, ragi, tobacco, groundnut and potato. So now we will go through some characteristics of wet soil. It is rich in iron oxide and is porous. It is poor in nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium and organic matter. It is loose and aerated. It is formed in poor rainfall areas, so it is very suitable for dry farming. It is not fertile, but it responds well to the fertilizers and it requires irrigation for cultivation. So now we are going to study about nitrite soil. It is formed as a result of atmospheric weathering of rocks in the conditions of higher rainfall and temperature with alternate wet and dry periods. This process is known as leaching. Leaching is also defined as the process in which the nutrients get percolated down below the soil due to heavy rainfall, thus leaving the topsoil infertile. This is also known as desilication. Laterite soil is mainly of two types, upland laterites, which are formed over hills and uplands, and the lower laterites, which are the upland laterites transported from uplands by streams. The major crops which have grown well in this soil are tapioca, cashew nuts, and with manure, we can also grow ragi, rice, sugarcane, tea, rubber, and coffee. Some kinds of laterite soil are dispersed and coarse. It is red due to the presence of iron oxide formed by leaching. It is poor in lime, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium and organic matter, and it is highly acidic in nature and very low moisture retentive. So now we are going to study about soil erosion. It is the removal of the top soil cover by water, wind and human activities. Some general causes of soil erosion are pollution, faulty agricultural practices, waste accumulation, overgrazing, heavy population pressure on land and deforestation. Go through soil erosion by water. First one, sheet erosion. It is the slow removal of a thin layer of soil when vegetation is destroyed. Second one, drill erosion. When sheet erosion continues for long, the silt-laden runoff forms many finger-like shaped rills or groups over a large area. This is called drill erosion. Third one, gully erosion. During heavy downpour, deep gullies are made of bare soils on account of water runoff. Fourth one, leaching. After harvesting, farmers have the soil bare for some time. During the rainfall, the nutrients in the soil are leached or percolated into the top layer. Fifth one, sea or shore erosion. The tidal waters of the sea cause considerable damage to the soil along the coast. And the last one is stream bank erosion. Streams and rivers change their courses by cutting one bank and depositing the silt loads on the other. Soil erosion by human action. Faulty agricultural practices like shifting agriculture, absence of vegetation, that is deforestation on mountain slopes, leads to sheet, drill and gully erosion. Overgrazing by animals, this leads to the removal of the top layer of the soil, thus soil erosion. Erosion by wind. Movement and deposition of soil particles by wind is known as wind erosion. Wind moves the soil particles by means of saltation and soil creep. Bouncing and hopping of soil particles is known as saltation, and the rolling of soil particles is known as soil creep. Wind erosion reduces the productivity of capacity of soil as most of the nutrients required by the plants are carried away by the wind. Now we are going to learn about some ways through which we can prevent soil erosion. First one, terrace farming. On hilly slopes, terraces act as burns and prevents the soil from being washed away by running water. Second is shelter builds. Farmers plant trees in several rows to check wind erosion. They are known as wind breaks. Contour plowing. Plowing along the contours of a slope prevents soil being washed away by wind or by surface runoff. Third one, strip cropping. Crops are grown in alternate strips of land to check the impact of winds. construction of dams. Rivers cause soil erosion. Dams are built in the upper course of the rivers to control erosion of soil. Plugging gullies. Gullies made in the soil are plugged with the deposition of silt during heavy rains. Planting of trees. The trees, like in the case of shelter belts, are planted along the edge of the field, the wasteland, on the steep slopes to prevent soil erosion as well as to enhance capacity of the soil to retain water. What is soil conservation? Soil conservation means prevention of soil loss from erosion, prevention of reduced fertility of soil caused by overusage, acidification, salinization, other types of soil contamination. Need for soil erosion to control gradual loss of soil fertility, prevent lowering underground water table, prevent drying of vegetation and extension of arid lands, protect soil from silting and slides.